Grace and peace to each of you this morning. Welcome to the service of worship and invite everyone to sign the friendship register. As you have signed it, please pass it to those seated next to you that we may have record of everyone's attendance. There are a couple of changes in the schedule for this week than what's listed in the bulletin, so please take a note. 4 p.m. this afternoon, Stewardship and Finance Committee will meet. And I got word early this morning that the Missions Committee will not meet till 6 p.m. this evening. And then Christian Relations will meet tomorrow at 6, and the Safety Task Force is also meeting tomorrow at 7. Tuesday night, Communications Committee will meet. Thursday of this week, the Jet Set will be going to Alta Pass Orchard. And they will have a wonderful outing there if you're encouraged to go and attend to that. Friday evening, 6 p.m., all of our children from, I think, kindergarten, maybe even a couple years younger if the parents are with them, but kindergarten through fifth grade, our children are encouraged to come to the garden for an overnight campout. And we plan on not only having a fun time together, but also doing some teaching. And Willie Pascoe will be showing them beehives and the product of beehives and all the good things that go with that, as well as some other things that they're going to be learning about preparing the garden for winter. So encourage the kids to come out. We'll have a wonderful evening together and a good morning on Saturday. Next Sunday will be Invite a Friend Sunday. If you are an older member of this church and you say, all my friends are in this church, then take a look around in the pews and see which of your friends are not here and invite them. Invite them back to church. If you're younger and you know a number of people that are beyond the congregation as far as your friends, invite some of them if they're not attending another church, and or if they are dissatisfied and are looking for another church, invite them to come. But the challenge for all of us, whether we invite a friend or not, is that when we have the friendly moment next week, we're going to actually take another couple of minutes beyond the normal time to do this. Be sure to welcome our guests. It would be very difficult for us, I think, and we'd lose momentum in where we're going if we invited people to that particular day and no one spoke to them on Sunday. So please, if we have Invite a Friend Sunday, which we will, then take a couple extra minutes next Sunday morning at the passing of the peace to greet these people when they're with us. This is an opportunity for us to grow the life of this congregation, which is something not just pastors do, but we all do together. Now let us, Jason has asked to have a moment to share something with you.
Another opportunity that we have to grow the life of our congregation, for those of you who don't have anything to do on Thursday morning, is our DCE 200 class. I'm hoping that a few more of you will block out a little bit of time. 9:30 Thursday morning to 10:15. It's 45 minutes. We have a great discussion. We look at Scripture from a different perspective. We don't just talk about history. We talk about how those first hearers would be encountering the Word of God. So far, we have a great quality group of people, but it's a small group. So think about DCE 200. Recognize that as you place God's Scripture in your heart, you help strengthen this fellowship. We're excited about what's happening.
I want to brag on him a second. Jason has started his work with the Union Theological Seminary Extension in Charlotte. He is starting his process to become a Master of Divinity. And this is a five-year process. Every Saturday for, 30 out of 52, Jason will be in school in Charlotte. So the course that he's teaching is going to be reflective of some of the learnings that he's been doing. I want to encourage you, if you have time and would like to, it'll be a worthwhile course.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his goodness.
Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases,
who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
Thank you.
sins, God, who is merciful and just, will forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In confidence, then, we dare to approach God responsibly. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
We confess, O Lord, that our sinful ways this past week deserve your anger.
He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever.
Thus we turn in repentance to you, seeking your forgiveness, as we us at this moment. We serve our hearts in many ways which we have sinned.
Take a moment of silent confession. Mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel, for in Jesus Christ we are all forgiven. May the God of mercy, who forgives us our sins, keep and abide each of us in eternal life, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. I brought something with me today that I bet most of you use just about every day. Pencils, that's right. Now, these pencils, they'll work, they will write, but what's wrong with them?
They won't erase.
They won't erase. See how their erasers are all worn down? You know what that says about me? That says I make a lot of mistakes, right? And that kind of reminds me of people, too, because we all make mistakes, don't we? Even sometimes we don't mean to, but we make them anyway. But that's why God sent Jesus to die on the cross, to erase our mistakes. And so when we do something wrong and we're really, really sorry about it, we can ask God to forgive us, and he will erase our mistakes so that we can start over again. Did you know that God wants you to forgive others just like he forgives you? Yeah, we know that, but is it easy to do all the time? No, especially if somebody does something that really hurts your feelings, it's hard to forgive them. But that's why God sent Jesus, so that we could help, so that we could forgive other people. In the Bible, there was a man named Peter, and he asked Jesus, how many times should I forgive someone? Should I forgive them seven times? Seven's a lot, isn't it? But Jesus said, no, Peter, not seven times. 70 times seven. Some of you learned that in Sunday school this morning, didn't you? 490 times. Do you think you can count to 490?
Yeah, that's it.
You might could. Some of you are very smart. But It would take you a long time, wouldn't it? And you, yeah, and you might even lose count before you got there. But that was the point that Jesus was making. He wants us to forgive people so many times that we lose count, because that's what God does for us. He doesn't keep track of how many mistakes we make. He just keeps on forgiving. Let's say a prayer. Dear God, we all make mistakes. Thank you for forgiving us without keeping track, and help us to show that same grace to others. Amen.
Pastoral concerns. I want to raise a few to you that I'm aware of. Nell Palmer has been in the hospital all week long, most of the time in ICU, although she went to a private room just, I think, yesterday or maybe Friday. But she is still trying to recover from the jaundice that is a byproduct of the chemotherapy that she's been taking and the cancer that she faces. So we keep her in our prayers. P.O. Wilson also is not a member of the church, but related to some of our members, and we keep him in our prayers because he is now in Augusta, Georgia, where he is undergoing therapy for the paralysis in his body. His hands are beginning to show some signs of progress, but he has learned this week that he probably will never walk again. So this is a big challenge for P.O., and we ask your prayers for him. Joseph Pritchard's brother, Mark Pritchard, was strong enough to go home from hospice. However, it is really a going home to die. And so we ask your prayers for the Pritchard family as he is in the last stages of his cancer. Then I would like for you to keep in mind some of our homebound members who are on our list this morning. Charlie Vinay is at home, and it's increasingly difficult for him to get out anymore. Linda Braswell and Benji Peru are at Autumn Care, and I'd ask your prayers for Emil Jackman as well. We also learned this week that Jeff Harvey has begun his chemotherapy and radiation treatment at MD Anderson once they were able to get Houston back in operations again. So he is going through that process and will be there for the next 5 weeks. It's a 6-week process for him. Are there other prayer concerns that any of you all know we should lift up? Yes. I would think she's in a private room and out of ICU now. So yes, she's in Carolina Reef Medical Center. Anyone else? Let us pray. We gather, O God, as your holy people. Our holiness is not so much in what we do, it's in what we believe. It is in who we serve. It is in how we are called to be in relationship with each other, even when that relationship becomes tested, and when we feel that our patience has worn thin. But that's what it means to be the church, to be connected with each other in service, to make hard decisions, to witness in faith, to be joyful in spirit. So we thank you, Lord, for the gift that you've given us, even in its hard days, when church is who we are and what we claim to be. We ask, Lord, your special blessing of love to be with those who we've mentioned this day that are going through times of difficulty and trial, especially with the long, drawn-out process of cancer for Nell. It's now in its 10th or 11th year. We ask your comfort for Mark in as he is progressively weaker, but is able to be at home now, and we ask your guiding spirit to give him peace and to free his body from any pain through the efforts of the hospice. Direct them, O God, as a family. Help them to know the power of your love is with them. We pray for our homebound members, not only the names of those we've mentioned this morning, but others in our midst. Others who are at College Pines and still others in various homes around our community. And we lift up to you, O God, those who are continuing to recover from the challenges that impacted the Southeast this past week in Irma, and those that are living in the Houston area and surrounding region in Texas as they recover from Hurricane Harvey. We thank you, Lord, for the response of people around this nation who have offered care and support in many different ways. And we pray that until the last person's life is restored, that those efforts be continued and that our hearts be softened to their needs. We are church. We claim the gift that you have given us in Christ, and the authority as well as the responsibility of being church together. So we offer our prayer and gratitude for that which you've given us through him, that which he bestows upon us in the power of his Holy Spirit. For we offer this prayer in Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Some days your word is tougher than others, and this is one of those days. So open us to the power of your grace that we see within it. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. From Matthew, we're literally picking up from the very next verse from where we were last week, when we talked about the focus on reconciliation. And this is the very next statement. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you," now there's other versions of this that use what we just heard, 7 times 70, however it says here 77 times. Both of them are about the same. "For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will repay you everything.' Out of pity for this man, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then this fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will repay you.' But he refused. Then he went out and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave as I have had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What is it about us as human beings that makes us want to always keep score? Oh yes, the first thing usually on a Sunday morning that I do after I've checked out the frontline hit news is to check out the football scores or the soccer scores or the basketball scores. I enjoy sports. But it's more than just sports, isn't it? We never seem to outgrow our need to judge others. "Did you see the size of the dessert he took? Mom and Dad, did you realize you got my brother or sister, and you fill in the name of your own child, a gift that was worth more than you got me?" Well, that's the 5th new car they bought in a decade. And in that time, we've only had one. And for those who like social media, do you ever play the comparison game? How many friends do you have on Facebook? How many of your friends wished you a happy birthday on Facebook? And what about your friends and peers on social media you knew decades ago? So you check them out online to see how well they've aged, how well they're living, etc., etc. And we privately think to ourselves, "Compared to so-and-so, I'm not doing so bad, am I?" Until we look at the travel pictures of our neighbor on Facebook, and we realize they've been to a lot more places than we have, and we think, "Well, I guess I'm not quite as good as they are." We console ourselves with the thought, "At least I'm better off than some." Peter, that guy whom Jesus called the rock on which he would build the church, is just like us. He is a scorekeeper just like us. I guess that's comforting in the sense of the word. Like many of us, Peter likes definite boundaries, and when it comes to forgiveness, he has a few of his own in mind. Over the past few years of being with Jesus, he had expanded his thinking about forgiveness. And so, with generosity in his heart, Peter approaches Jesus with a question, but he also proposes an answer. Jesus, if another member of the church sins against me, how often must I forgive them? As many as 7 times? Most of us would think that's a pretty generous response, and Peter certainly did. Now, if you were with us last week, you remember we read and preached on the verses immediately preceding this. But even the week before that, we talked about carrying the cross, taking up our cross, and living a life of discipleship. So the theme for both of those weeks is also applicable to the theme of this week. What does it mean to be the church? To be the church today, with the scriptural focus, is that we examine the issue of forgiveness and its role in our lives, because the church cannot be the church, and individually we cannot be part of the body of Christ, unless we engage in the practice of forgiveness every day. So Peter asked the question of us, or for us, and we watch to see what kind of answer he's given. You see, he thinks he's right, because the number 7 is an indication in the Bible of the theme of wholeness or completeness. Oh, he's, excuse me, he's asking, I have a complete answer here, right? And Jesus says, no, not 7 times, but 77 times, or in the, I think it's in the book of Luke, 7 times 7. Jesus tells Peter, essentially, there's no limit. 77, then, is code for don't keep score. Or it's like an emoji for infinity. That's how we should be thinking about that text. Forgive as much as God has forgiven you, Peter. Are we going to start counting that? How many of you watched the program the other night on Martin Luther? At the end of October, we will be celebrating the 500th anniversary of his posting of the 95 theses, or the debate questions that he wanted to raise with the church. He posted them on the Wittenberg door, and it was the start of the Reformation. But what we learn about Martin Luther, particularly the other night in this program, was that early on in his life, his father had designs for him to become a lawyer for the family practice. Luther didn't feel that was what he was called to do. In fact, he was called to be a monk, so he went into training in a monastery. Part of his training involved confessing his sins. But Luther had a very, very difficult time, far more unusual for a man in his age, because he felt that despite what he did, he had too many sins to confess. He would engage in what's called flagellation, that is the taking of a whip and whipping your back over and over. He also would go out at nighttime, in the middle of winter, in northern Germany, to sleep on the ground as a way of punishing and purging his body from sin. His mentor was his confessor, and he would spend hours at a time confessing his sins. Poor mentor, right? Having to hear this man's sins over and over and over and over again. And then when he'd get out of the room, he'd come back 2 minutes later and have to confess something else. Something was wrong with Luther. The only kind of help that would give him any kind of solace was in reading the scriptures. He read from Romans 3 and 4 and understood. understood for the first time in a light bulb aha moment that grace was a gift from God, that it was undeniable, and that if a person simply believed in God, that grace was available. That was the source of forgiveness for Luther. He was so taken by that text, he ran downstairs in the middle of the night to talk to his neighbor, another monk, and tell him what he'd found. Perhaps it was even his mentor. So let's run a little experiment this morning. If you were to calculate the number of times during the past week that you caught yourself sinning, how many times would that be? Think about not just the things that you know you did that were wrong. Think about the things you left out that you realized a little voice inside calling you to do, but you didn't do it. Think about the number of times you stretched your truth to make it a white lie. Think about the number of times that you disrupted and upset family members. Would seven times cover that? Now, in that 1 week, imagine 52 weeks and multiply whatever number you come up with. And now, this is where it gets a little harder, particularly for those of us with white hair. Consider the number of years times the number of times you sin. And what number have you got? Will 7 cover it? Will 77 cover it? No. Because what Jesus is saying is, don't keep score. Don't keep score. Because that infinite number of 77 symbolizes the total nature of God's grace. It's not something we can earn. It is not something we can even measure by the number of sins we've committed over the course of a lifetime. It makes it a little bit more insightful as to what Jesus is all about here. If we're his disciples, we are obligated to be in community with each other. And you can't be in community without having to come to terms with the messiness and the ugliness and the sinfulness of each other and ourselves. But we have elected to be in community with each other, which means that we at times suffer hurt, and at other times we celebrate with joy, but we remain together. Challenging words. One of you said this past week, "Preacher, you were stepping on my toes this past Sunday." Actually, I heard that from a number of people. If this one doesn't do it, I don't know what will. Have you got your combat boots on today, folks? Because this sermon really puts it to every single one of us, because that's the nature of who we are as human beings. Consider that when Jesus teaches us to pray, he says, pray like this: forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. There's some parity between how he's saying God will forgive us and how we forgive our neighbors. And if we have a difficult time forgiving our neighbors, what does that say about our relationship with God? I was telling David this morning after Sunday school class that years ago, when I was 33, there was a parent of a child who happened to also be an elder, that the parent did, in my congregation. This child was in the 7th grade, and she was one of those children that your heart bled for, because she made her own mistakes just by being in a room with anybody else. And 7th graders, particularly 7th grade girls, were particularly hard on her. But she also was the kind that would say, "I'm going to tell on you," and, you know, go off and tell. And I tried working with that girl for 3 years. until her daddy called me and said to me, "I expected more from you. You have not been the kind of youth leader that I needed for my daughter, and I cannot forgive you." An elder telling me, "I cannot forgive you." I said, "Please, George, please accept my apology, because I have tried and I will continue. I have not given up on your child." "That's irrelevant, sir. You are irresponsible and an ineffective youth pastor." I got a little angry. And so we went tete-a-tete. Looking at that as age 62, now I look back and say, he was projecting his problems, his concerns about his daughter's ability to fit in with other people, and expecting me, with the 2 hours a week that I had with that child, to be able to correct it all. Wrong. I was able to forgive him long, long ago. I don't think he ever did. Years ago, I learned, in going back to that community and worshiping with them again, I asked about George. "How's George doing?" "Well, he's suffered from alcoholism. He's lost his job at Ole Miss. He is no longer able to function." It changed my perspective on George, but it also told me what kind of battles were going on in his family life, and that he really was hoping that a youth pastor could do something to help with his daughter's difficulty in getting along with others. We're called to forgive. I think the fact that George couldn't forgive was part of what was eating at his soul, probably fueling the alcoholism. So when we think about forgiveness, just what is it? We asked that question this morning, and we wrestle with its understanding. What is it? Forgiveness means to release, to let go of the other. Forgiveness is not denying or forgetting our hurt. It isn't minimizing the serious offense by saying that it was nothing, don't think about it. And if we say that kind of self-subjugating comment and are not truthful with ourselves and the impact of that wrong in our lives, we really haven't forgiven. We've only dismissed. True forgiveness is a possibility only when we acknowledge to ourselves and to the wrongdoer what kind of impact that action had personally in my life or on the lives of those I love and care about. Eleanor Roosevelt, after finding out that her husband had engaged in infidelity, said to him, "I can forgive you, but I can never forget." And neither should we, about those sins that are really important, that do damage in life. The infidelity of a spouse, abuse, betrayal, ethnic cleansing, racial and religious purging, the Holocaust. We dare not forget, but we can forgive. I want to close with a story. It's one I've shared with you before, but it was so important. It's so powerful that I want to read it again. It's from Rabbi Harold Kushner, reflecting on his own congregation. "A woman in my congregation comes to see me. She's a single mother, divorced, working to support herself and 3 young children. She says to me, 'Since my husband walked out on us, every month is a struggle to pay our bills. I have to tell you, our kids, I have no money to go to the movies, while he is living it up in another state with his new wife. How can you tell me to forgive him?' I answer her," says Kushner, "'I'm not asking you to forgive him because what he did was acceptable, because it wasn't. It was mean and selfish. I am asking you to forgive him because he doesn't deserve the power to live in your head and to turn you into a bitter and angry woman. I'd like to see him out of your life emotionally as completely as he is out physically. But you keep holding on to him. You're not hurting him by holding on to that resentment. You're hurting yourself. Forgiveness is so very important to us in community. Without it, we become broken if we are unable to forgive. Without it, our relationships with other people become broken. Either the person who's been the perpetrator or everyone else who has to listen to our song and dance story over and over again. Community is who we are. A community in Christ. A community guided by the one who on the cross said, "Father, forgive them." Even when it was hard for him to forgive, he asked God to forgive. That's what we can do, is it not? Release it into God's hands. Our Father, forgive us our debts, our trespasses, our sins, as we forgive our debtors, those who sin against us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand and join with me as together we affirm our faith. We believe that in the death of Jesus on the cross, God achieved and demonstrated once for all the costly forgiveness of our sins. Jesus Christ is the reconciler between God and the world. He acted on behalf of sinners as one of us, fulfilling the obedience God demands of us, accepting God's condemnation of our sinfulness. In his lonely agony on the cross, Jesus felt forsaken by God, and thus experienced hell itself for us. Yet the Son was never more in accord with the Father's will. He was acting on behalf of God, manifesting the Father's love that takes on itself the loneliness, pain, and death that result from our waywardness. In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not holding our sins against us. Each of us beholds on the cross the Savior who died in our place so that we may no longer live for ourselves, but for him. In him is our only hope of salvation. Amen. Please be seated. We are free, you and I, free from an inability to forgive, free to love, free to give of our lives and our gifts of gratitude to God. You have bestowed on us the gift of grace, a grace that we receive with open arms, but also learn how to share with open arms. Use our lives and use these gifts for the promise that you have in this world to restore everything to your will. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.